Good morning and welcome to the sixth meeting in 2024 of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. I remind all members and witnesses to ensure that their devices are on silent. We've received apologies from Miles Briggs and are joined by Brian Whittle, who's attending as a substitute member. And Stephanie Callaghan is joining us online. And as this is Brian's first time attending a meeting of this committee, the first item on our agenda is to invite Brian Whittle, MSP, to declare any relevant interests.
Thank you, convener. Nothing to declare.
Thank you. The second item on our agenda today is to decide whether to take items 4 and 5 in private. Are members agreed? We're all agreed. The second item on our agenda today is to take evidence as part of our Housing to 2040 inquiry in a roundtable format. And we are joined in the room by John Blackwood, who's the Chief Executive of Scottish Association of Landlords, Michael Cameron, who's the Chief Executive at the Scottish Housing Register, Maureen Chalmers, who is a community wellbeing spokesperson from COSLA, Callum Chomchuk, who is the National Director at the Chartered Institute of Housing Scotland, Sally Thomas, who's the Chief Executive of the Scottish Federation of Housing Associations, and John Mills, who is the co-chair at the Association of Local Authority Chief Housing Officers, otherwise known as ALACHO, and Jane Wood, who is the Chief Executive of Homes for Scotland. I welcome our witnesses to the meeting, and I'm going to begin our conversation this morning by inviting everyone to very briefly introduce themselves, and I'll begin. I'm Arianne Burgess, convener of the committee and also MSP for the Highlands and Islands, and I'll go this way.
Sally Thomas, Chief Executive of the Scottish Federation of Housing Associations.
Mark Griffin, MSP for Central Scotland and member of the committee.
John Mills, co-chair of ALACHO and head of housing at Fife Council.
Pam Gosselaar, member of the Scottish Parliament for the West Region.
Councillor Maureen Chalmers, I'm a councillor in South Lanarkshire and the COSLA Community Wellbeing Spokesperson.
And Brian Whittle, South of Scotland MSP.
John Blackwood, Chief Executive of the Scottish Association of Landlords.
Callum Homechook, National Director at Chartered Institute of Housing Scotland.
Marie McNair, MSP, representing the Claybank and Mogai constituency.
Michael Cameron, Chief Executive with the Scottish Housing Regulator.
Jane Wood, Chief Executive, Homes for Scotland.
I'm Willie Coffey, MSP for Kilmarnock and Irvine Valley.
Hey, thanks very much for that. So we're going to turn to questions and please indicate me if you want to come in or respond to a member's question or to another comment that somebody else has made. And the intention, as much as possible for this session, is to be as free-flowing a conversation as we can manage, although we do have questions that we want to kind of lead the conversation through. So you know, sometimes it might be that you don't get to come in on a question, but you can tuck your response in when you come in at another time. Also, don't feel you have to respond to every single question. There might be things that are really pertinent to some of you more so than others. But I tend to ask an initial question, which is kind of quite overarching, getting a kind of big picture. So it'd probably be good to hear from you all on that one. And that really is. So, I mean, I guess it's great that we're all here talking about Housing to 2040 and doing a bit of a review and a bit of checkup on where we think we're at. And I think it's great to have all of you in the room because you've been involved or your organisations have been involved in setting that Housing to 2040 direction. Obviously, housing has been a long-term intractable problem. It's not just a problem of now. It's a problem for decades. Getting affordable housing into the mix has been something that we've been trying to tackle across the United Kingdom since the First and Second World War, that time. So it's a long-term problem, and it'll be interesting to hear from you where you think we're at now. So in that regard, I'd be interested to hear from you what your view of the high-level vision for housing set out in Housing to 2040. I'd like to hear your view of it. Is it still relevant, or does it need amended in any way in light of the changed economic context since 2021? And I invite someone to... Callum, come on in.
Thank you, convener. Housing at 24, I think, was a fantastic vision document for the sector. I think it was really appropriate that it set a long-term vision for what we want to see in Scotland's housing system. I think looking at trying to address the cost of housing, build better quality homes, more homes, I think there's nothing in that detail, in that vision, I think, that anyone would disagree with. The challenge is the delivery. The challenge of Housing 24, it was a vision document, but it didn't have an implementation plan, didn't have funding behind it, didn't set out timescales. Not even looking across 20 years, but looking across the 5 years of this Parliament that we're in. And that's where we fall down. I don't think we need to go back and unpick Housing at 2040, but what we need to do is actually focus on what we can deliver in this Parliament. I think fundamentally the biggest problem we're facing in this Parliament is a lack of supply and a lack of social supply. We're already facing challenges since 2021. The most recent budget cuts, I know we'll get into, have exacerbated a pretty devastating situation. We all want to see higher quality homes. We all want to see more supply. Housing at 2040 sets out that vision. But what we really need to see now is actually delivery and fundamentally money behind it.
OK, that's very helpful. So I'm going to add to my initial question for other people coming in, because you've already started to touch on it, and I think it's great. You've progressed the conversation already into the delivery. So in anyone else's responses, it would be good to hear your thoughts around strategic challenges such as the ones that Callum has indicated, including for councils, and just anything around that in terms of implementing the vision. John.
Yeah, I mean, absolutely, the sector welcomed the 2040 vision, because it actually said, or government and political parties at that time said, we will keep to the commitments no matter what. And I think that was the welcome. It was the first long-term vision over a 20-year horizon, if you want to certainly increase housing supply and eradicate homelessness in Scotland. So I think that's still true. I think what we've suffered in the last few years is strong headwinds through the pandemic and obviously now through the financial situation. For councils, I agree with Callum, it's very much about surviving the next 2 or 3 years of really intensive housing pressures and homelessness pressures from a variety of sources, not just people in temporary accommodation just now, which is at a record level, but from resettlement exercises such as Ukrainians, welcome home, and also the asylum seeker dispersal. So if you take all that together, and in the recent RAG analysis that Alacho carried out on behalf of the sector, around about 14 to 15 local authorities were moving towards a housing emergency. So that tells you that the focus needs to be over the next 2 to 3 years, while keeping faith with the longer term vision.
Thanks very much. Anybody else? Jane.
Long-term vision, good. I think one of the challenges that we face with the delivery and implementation of Housing 2040 ambitions is that it has very little flex. It doesn't respond to the context that we're operating in. And I think the context has to be looked at as it's been in a long time coming. We've seen the housing supply numbers fall since 2008. We have different economic conditions. We have different regulations and policies coming through. And I don't think that we are understanding the unintended consequences ultimately on the housing supply for the Scottish population. So we're not reactive at pace. So I think for us, we would welcome, and we welcome working closely with government, but we would welcome more if we can look and understand the barriers and break them down. It's very complex. Housing is a very complex issue. Now, whether that's around investing in the planning system, whether it's around identifying the policies that are maybe stopping housing supply, whether it's about understanding where rural build, you know, what we need to do economically. So I think, you know, we need to do a short-term and mid-term plan in light of where we are with the housing crisis and the falling trajectory, because it doesn't feel that we have anything on the table at the moment that's increasing housing supply. And I think that's got to be a priority of Housing 2040. I think in terms of Housing 2040 itself, I think it would be good to understand a little more about the resource that's put into it, because it's a big plan, it's complex. We are obviously sitting there as advisers, and we want to support, but I think, you know, we'd like to understand the resource that government puts in to support that, because it needs a lot of chunky work being done at this point.
Okay,
Thanks very much. Just to say you don't need to operate your mics, we'll do that for you. One less thing to think about, not having to deal with technology. Sally, you've indicated you want to come in.
To speak. I'm going to start off by saying that Housing 2040 was a hugely admirable piece of work, is a hugely admirable piece of work, and sets Scotland ahead of the rest of the UK in terms of housing policy and vision. And it was groundbreaking in that sense. It is, unfortunately, unravelling. And that unravelling really started with COVID and was continued through the cost of living crisis, the inflationary pressures coming out of COVID. Brexit didn't help. There's been an ongoing increase in expectation in terms of standards and quality of homes, therefore cost. That's not necessarily a bad thing, but there is a cost implication. And it was kind of the hammer came down, if you like, with the budget cut that we've just seen in the budget before Christmas of 26% on the housing programme, on the affordable housing supply programme. And that exacerbated the previous year's cut. So we're looking at an overall cut over those 2 years of round about kind of 50% if we look at the figures in real time. And so we've gone from a point of Scotland being leading edge, being in the vanguard, with a vision that still stands for the most part, despite the challenges that we know are there, to a point where we're really struggling to make it work in terms of the housing that the people of Scotland need and deserve.
Thanks very much for that. John, and then Maureen.
Can I just say, first of all, of course, on behalf of the private rental sector, we very much support and welcome the vision of 2040, and indeed we've incorporated that within our own strategy as an organisation. In supporting private landlords and letting agents, one thing that we are really concerned about is future investment in the sector and how the private rented sector can not just survive but can thrive in the future to provide the many homes that we're going to need here in Scotland. We've estimated from our research that in the last year alone we could have lost 22,000 properties to rent in the private rented sector, and that's quite catastrophic. And with a further 56% of our members saying that over the next 5 years, they intend to disinvest in the sector and exit. So we need to look at who's going to be providing private rented accommodation in the future, how can we support them, and what can we do within the strategy to encourage new investment and encourage those who are providing good homes for people to live in at the moment to continue to do so. So that's one of the main challenges that we think 2040 faces.
Okay, thanks very much. Maureen.
Thank you. I mean, many people already have kind of made the points that, you know, I could make too. I think one of the what would be helpful to us is, first of all, you know, there's a housing emergency across many local authorities in Scotland, and it's the supply of housing and the affordable housing supply programme cuts in budget that are proposed in budget really will mean there's less homes when we've got 250,000 people waiting for a home. So that's one of the big challenges that local government's dealing with right now. I think there's a kind of misalignment or kind of needing to realign Scottish Government's policy on housing and homelessness with that kind of budget decision and also the ethos of the programme. The disconnect between Scottish Government's housing policy and the current economic climate and local government finances and the ever-increasing level of demand for local authority social housing means that there could be further homelessness emergencies declared by local authorities. I think Heriot-Watt University have predicted that the homelessness will rise within a third in the next couple of years. And we've also got homelessness statistics due at the end of this month that we fear will be have seriously increased. So we're concerned about all of that and concerned for that need to bring policies together to make sure that we can achieve what we need to achieve. The last point I'd make would be the human protection schemes and the need for some kind of coherence across both the protection schemes that are led at a UK level, but also between what UK government are doing, what Scottish government are doing across all the human protection schemes to make it a wee bit easier for us to work at local government level and making sure that all our guests who arrive in Scotland have got the opportunity for good housing.
Thanks very much for that. So I take away from that round that, in general, the vision, you're all tremendously supportive of the vision. It is just the what comes in behind that to support that actually happening, and some of the things that have come up against that in terms of COVID in the previous years that have prevented us from really rolling that out. So that's good to hear that the vision still stands. It's just really how we actually make it happen and the potential for needing to give it a bit of a review. I'd like to bring in Pam Gosol now with a couple of questions.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to everybody attending today in the panel. Jane, you spoke about understanding the barriers and breaking them down, and you mentioned that area around planning. So obviously we all know that Scotland is facing a housing shortage at this moment, and therefore critical action needs to be taken, especially in our planning system. Despite a drop in applications for major housing developments and for local housing developments, application process times are both far exceeding the statutory time frame. On top of this, the Scottish Government announced a 43% reduction in the planning budget. What actions can be taken to implement meaningful change as quickly as possible so that Scotland's people have the homes that they need and deserve? And Jane, because you spoke about obviously the planning side, I'll go to yourself first.
Thank you for that question, and thank you for giving me an opportunity to talk about one of what is considered by our members one of the key issues, which is planning. I think there are multiple areas within planning. There is local and there's a planning regime, and I think we need a systemic approach to planning. I think that planning has been decades of underinvestment. So I think this is not a short, an immediate problem. I think it's been a long time coming. I think what we need to look at, we have just conducted a Scotland-wide housing needs survey that many of you may have seen, that identifies that we are not bringing forward in local development plans the housing needs. We're not understanding what the true housing needs are across our country. Our survey showed, it was 13,000 representative people we spoke to, shows that we're looking at 28% deficit in housing need that we're accounting for through local development plans. So one of the things that I would say as a solution, which I think is what you're asking, Pam, is first of all, we need to make sure we're collecting contextual data and evidence about what is the solution we're trying to solve. And I think that's very important. And we created this research to try and support local authorities and government with giving them data that we felt was very contextual and relevant. I think the second thing is that there can be some short-term solutions, I think, and it's going to, the budget that I understand when I asked the planning minister about the 43% drop that you discussed, I understand that's coming from the digitization of the planning system. That's a concern. At a time when I think there has been much evidence given that the planning system is under-resourced. We have very few planners coming through as graduates, so we don't even have the profession, having been able to fulfil the capacity that's required. So I think local authorities struggle. I think that at a local level, the planning applications you refer to, that is having an immediate impact on housing numbers because they're taking too long. I think we need to be very clear on the broader impact of the delay in planning applications. So if you've got a small and medium-sized builder who are critical, and we see that in the Rural Action Plan, to delivering the houses we need across rural conurbations especially, if you've got a 54-week planning wait when you were anticipating 12-week, the upfront capital that small and medium builders have to put out, that's not sustainable for their business model. So we've got a lot of people, it's becoming more and more difficult to put the applications in because of the managing, the cost implications, the time. That's meaning back to the statement that Mr. Blackwood said, was that this is becoming an industry sector that's becoming more difficult to operate within the planning system. And our businesses are saying to us, if we don't sort the planning system, the investment, is going to be more difficult. Why would we invest in Scotland? Because it just doesn't work. So I think the solutions are immediate short-term investment and maybe some exemptions. I think there's vacant and derelict land that needs to be looked at as well. So we can find and identify ways to bring forward more brownfield land to build on. So there are a number, and we have actually put these to government in terms of some of the solutions that we think would create a surge capacity in planning.
Thank you. Can I move the question on to Maureen? Maureen, you talked about the disconnect between budgets and demand and homelessness. So do you have anything to say around my question on planning? Because obviously, is there a disconnect with budgets here, or is there a disconnect with delivery or understanding who, you know, the customer is here?
I think planning budgets, within council budgets over the last few years, because what happens locally is that people try to protect education, social work and other key services, it's areas like planning where if savings can be found, that's where people go. So then on top of that, we had the pandemic, and now we've got all the challenges we've got just now. I think it's recognised at local level that that's an issue. So we have just set up a special interest group within COSLA, a housing special interest group. And that was in recognition two things. One, that within local government, we need to bring together all the key players, not just housing folk that are around the table or the elected members who lead in housing, but we've also got the planning, so apart from Alacho, where our professional advisors, we've now got planners on that, and we'll bring in health and social care too, who are a key player. So we've just had our first meeting of that group, but that is senior councillors coming together with a wider set of advisors to bring all those issues around the table and look for those solutions from our perspective. But also, because I co-chair the House in 2040 with the Minister set up a ministerial oversight group, and we're going to make sure that those two groups connect and try and work through some of those big chunky issues together. So we're trying to find the way forward because we recognise there is an issue. Yeah.
Just want to open up to anybody else, really.
Want to pick up the question? No. Do you want to go on to your next one?
Yeah, thank you, convener. Just going on, Callum spoke a little bit about the lack of supply and lack of social housing and lack of quality housing as well. I've been fortunate enough to speak to 31 local authorities out of 32, and I know there are growing demand for accessible housing, especially when we look at how the demographic is set to change and our ageing, especially with our ageing population. Freedom of Information request from the Scottish Conservatives also revealed that there are around 40,000 disabled people on the social housing waiting list. To what extent is the Scottish Government adequately balanced the need to address short-term housing problems against the long-term housing priorities? And do any priorities there need to change? And I'll put my question.
Pamela, I think it's an excellent question. We have this perpetual conflict around actually supply and inequality of our homes that we want to build. Sally talked about it, mentioned it earlier. We want to see higher standards at home. We're ambitious for tenants. Tenants are ambitious for themselves. Landlords want to deliver the highest possible quality homes that they can. That's why we're focused. So we focus on more accessible homes, kind of net zero homes. But fundamentally, we need more homes. We need to be able to do everything. We need to be able to do more than one thing at the same time. Our crisis right now is on supply. We can see it in the homeless figures. We've mentioned it already. We'll probably mention it continually. We can see the trends are coming homelessness. We see the length of the waiting list. We know the impact the budget cuts are going to have on future supply chains. We need to invest in that. But you're absolutely right. We also need to be mindful about the standards of the home we're building. So we need to have that prioritisation from the government within this parliamentary term. As we talked earlier, Housing at 2040 is a hugely ambitious document. It sets out a number of things we all want to see in the housing system. They're all not possible at the same time. And I think that's fundamentally where we are. And I think certainly Charter Institute, and I think broadly across sector, what we need to see is a sense of prioritisation. What is it we want to achieve as a sector within the next few years? We need to have high standards of home. We need to have more wheelchair accessible homes to ensure people with disabilities can live in a home that's suitable to their needs. Because quite frankly, it's a failure of government, failure of public policy if people are in kind of inappropriate housing. But we also need to build more homes. That will make other choices, not just within the housing sphere. If there are other parts of the public policy that need to, public sector decision making need to be compromised to deliver on housing, then that's a political decision. But what we will say is we need to build more homes, but we need to build more accessible homes, and we need to build kind of zero carbon homes. The purpose, I think, of Housing 2040 is ensure we see the priorities set out and a pathway to deliver on them.
Well, thank you. John, do you want to mention anything? Because I know that you mentioned around the fact that councils are going to obviously have a lot to deal with the next 2 to 3 years. So obviously these are councils that we're speaking to. So
yes, I mean, I think as part of the local housing need and demand assessments that we've carried out across my part of Scotland, which is Fife, Tayside and South East Scotland, we carried out wheelchair needs assessment in both Fife and Edinburgh City. and there was a significant shortfall in terms of express need and available supply. So what we've done in Fife, just through the local housing strategy in the last year, is doubled our quota for wheelchair housing. Now, it's only local authorities and housing associations that are building bungalows, which are the typical house type you would think about, and we need to see that across all tenures so that people have a choice to buy as well as rent, but we're not building enough of those properties. And I think the proposed cut in the affordable housing programme will probably slow down that build even further. So we're very aware of the need, and we need to keep building probably about 10% of our programme over the next 10 to 20 years to try and meet some of that need.
Sally, is there anything you want to add to this?
Yes. I was going to just add a couple of facts and figures. Housing 2040 set out that 61,000 people needed adaptations to their homes for the reasons that you've raised. And that figure was based on a 2018 report by the Equality and Human Rights Commission, which itself references Scottish Government work from 2015. So, I mean, that all makes it obvious that we're way out of date on this, and the figures will now be much higher. We know there's 40,000 people on the 250,000 waiting list who have got disabilities at the very least. And what we, I think what we conclude from all of that is that, A, the need will have increased, and, B, that we need a single national cross-tenure framework for dealing with adaptations and accessible housing. And the final point I'd make is to say that all that means that we need much more social housing to deal with the numbers of people who need housing and the numbers of people who need accessible housing.
Thank you, Convener, unless anybody else wants to come in.
Thank you. I'm just going to follow up on that with a couple of questions, just a kind of a broad one. Be interested to hear people's reflection on kind of picking back up on the balancing piece, and to hear your reflections on what you think, or to what extent you think the Scottish Government are adequately balancing the need to address the short-term housing problems that we've heard against the longer-term housing policy and aims, and do any priorities need to change? Anybody want to come in on that? John?
Certainly, what we believe in Alacho needs to happen is you need to focus absolutely on the next 1 to 3 years. And to do that, instead of proposing a cut to the affordable housing programme, you need to boost the programme. So I know money's tight across the country, across the UK, but developing social housing actually tackles a number of priorities for the government: poverty, child poverty, and homelessness. And obviously the resettlement schemes that we're running just now on behalf of UK and Scottish Government, all of that demands that you actually front-load the programme over the next 3 years rather than reduce it. Mm-hmm. So fundamentally, that's what needs to shift, that thinking around trying to get as many homes built or bought as possible, because acquisitions has a big role to play in the next 3 years plan.
One of the issues that we've heard quite a lot in the committee has been around, in terms of getting the housing built, is around workforce. So do you think if there's the money there, do we have the people to actually build the houses?
Certainly. Callum will come in on this as well, but we have had a shortage since pandemic for a number of reasons: ageing workforce, leaving the workforce, retiring early or flexible retirement, or moving on to other types of work. And so that has gradually improved over the last 2 or 3 years. But in terms of the housing bill, the government asked us to do a resource assessment across the all the local authorities. And certainly we do not have enough staff to actually invest in significant scaling up of prevention of homelessness. So that's the part that we need to have further discussions through COSLA and through Scottish Government. So yes, there is a shortage of staff to actually implement that major provision in the new bill.
Okay. Thanks. I'm going to bring in Brian Whittle with, I think, a supplementary question. I've got another one, and then I'll bring in Jane to respond to, I think, my question. Brian.
Thank you, Convener. I was actually really interested, Callum, you brought up net zero housing now, and the ambitions around reducing our carbon output through housing. And, of course, that's across new builds. There is the retrofitting of 1 million homes, which we've had to drop. We're 22,500 tradespeople short to hit those sort of 2030 targets, and it seems to me that one of the things, and a reducing budget as well. So one of the things I would, should we be considering taking that capital and looking at addressing, you know, homelessness, addressing lack of housing by building new affordable green housing and incentivising builders to do that, because it seems to me that the budget's been spread very thin, which means that no targets are being hit. Are we too scattergun in the approach to
I think that's a really fair question. I think we are trying to do a lot of things at the same time. We have got a rightful and understandable focus on trying to make our housing stock as energy efficient as possible. That's incredibly positive. You'll know the information that the social sector is kind of first in class. You know, where it's already the most energy efficient housing stock that exists in Scotland, and it continues to do so. But unless we're realistic about timelines and funding, we're going to fail to meet the targets. We need to set a kind of plan, as John said. We need to be realistic about what we want and what we can deliver. We're all ambitious for our housing stock. We all want to have the best possible housing. But unless the government's able to provide adequate funding, the only source for that will be from tenants. And it'll be tenants who pay for it through higher and higher rents. So I think it is a fair question. If we are wanting to deliver on the homelessness and housing crisis, we need to reflect on what other priorities need to be paced differently. And that everything has to be on the table at that point.
The question is then, should we be focusing on the new build affordable homes,
yeah,
developing a green, energy efficient new affordable homes rather than the widespread?
So we obviously want to build new greener homes, but my point is around the kind of what standards we're going to hit over a piece of time. Is it realistic? Are our current standards for delivering energy efficient homes and social housing sector realistic given the kind of capital that's available? And I think it's a question about how we are best to time the delivery of housing at an ever increasing standard, particularly when we look at the retrofit and the existing homes, because, you know, in 10 years most of the homes we have will be the homes that currently exist. Actually, I think it's a useful question to consider. Do we need to just reconsider the timeframes around delivery of green homes so that we can actually put investment into building more homes that actually meet the needs of people today to get out of this emergency?
Jane, and then Michael, and then I'm going to come back in with a question.
Yes, so I think importantly, somebody talked about prioritising 1 to 3 years. I think we need to stand back, and I think when we talk about housing, we need to look at it, first of all, through the optics of all tenure. We need to recognise the interdependencies across social, affordable and private, and that economy, that market that it sits in. That's really important. I think, secondly, we need to recognise the social and economic impact of housing. And sometimes we forget that. We forget the economy, the 3.4 billion it provides to the Scottish economy, circa 80,000 jobs. Housing, the other thing I really think we need to look at as we go forward into the next 3 years, is this has to sit across directorates. I think one of the issues that we have with housing, because it's so complex, that government, every directorate in the government needs to have housing as some kind of a KPI or an inhibitor or a contributor to that national outcome. It feeds into all our national outcomes across net zero, mental well-being, educational attainment. And I think if we can look at that and make it a policy and political priority across how we deliver Scotland's national outcomes, I think the thinking will change, and I think we'll get more joined up thinking, which we have urged government to do for a long time. Can I just talk very briefly about capacity? I've heard this before. I think it might be good to remember that back in 2007, the Scottish government itself stated that we needed to build 35,000 all-tenure homes a year. Between 2008 and 2023, we've only been building between 17,000 and 22,000 homes a year. There is the problem.
Thanks, Michael.
Thank you, Convener. It's just to follow up on the point around, in particular, investment in existing homes, and the point that Callum has made around the reality that almost all housing need is met through the homes that are already there. There are around 600,000 social homes. That's where the bulk of the need that we see in front of us right now and in the coming years will be met from. So I think there is absolutely a critical need to increase the level of supply, absolutely. But I think it would be it would compromise our ability to meet need if we didn't also focus on existing stock. And in particular, to ensure that existing stock is at the standards that are both expected by government but also expected by tenants. So that investment, I think, has to be considered in terms of both new build and the existing homes there. Now, the Scottish Government is currently consulting on its proposed net zero standard. I think there's a lot of uncertainty for landlords around that. Landlords haven't necessarily been planning and projecting the financial requirements around investment to meet that standard. And I think that we will see over the coming year, as the standard is defined and landlords start to do that work, that we're facing a very significant capital investment requirement. We've estimated for RSLs alone, for registered social landlords alone, so not for local authorities, that cost will be somewhere between about £4 and £9 billion to bring those homes up to that proposed standard. That's money that has to either come from public subsidy or through rent that's paid by tenants. So I think it's critical that we keep both of those in our focus.
Thanks very much for that contribution. Actually, kind of brings the conversation back to the question I'd wanted to ask a while ago, which is around retrofitting, and also around the Scottish Government has a declared town centre first approach. And some of you may be aware that Scotland's Town Centre Partnership and Scotland's Futures Forum and others are doing a roadshow around town centre living at the moment and looking at bringing more people in living into town centres and looking at the fact that there's above commercial properties, you have quite a lot of empty potential for housing. So we've got an empty homes register. I think it has acknowledges about 40,000 empty homes. But we've also got these commercial properties that don't acknowledge those potential empty homes above commercial properties. So I just wonder what your thoughts are around that. And I would maybe go to Alacho and Kosla on this initially, and then Callum, maybe you could come in on it too. That's perhaps a low-hanging fruit. What I understand is that actually it'd be about a third less to actually get in, even with retrofitting, to get in and actually retrofit and renovate those properties. And obviously we'd have to think quite cleverly about how we make them relevant for modern living. There's probably quite a few of them that are smaller rooms, but how do we bring in the designers and architects to think well about how do we make those spaces work? And I've seen some tremendous case studies through this roadshow of what people are doing, renovating, transforming church spaces and that kind of thing. So I think there's an opportunity there. I'd be interested to hear what you think about that, and does that fit into this Housing to 2040 vision?
Yes, I mean we certainly would be very much in favour of a town centre first approach as part of a local housing strategy. And indeed it is in many of the local housing strategies across Scotland. I think the low-hanging fruit part is probably where you have gap sites available. And certainly we've just developed one in Fife where we've built on a gap site. Costs tend to be higher, in my view, than a greenfield new build development. But that's part of the cost of bringing people back into town and city centres. I think part of the difficulties in looking at, flats above shops, is that we need to consider the ownership arrangements, and they tend to be complex. The only tool that local authorities have if it wants to adopt a scheme in a particular part of a town centre is a compulsory purchase order approach, or work with the owners collaboratively to try and bring investment into those properties. So I think we need to think about particular focus on town centres as a strategic approach supported by planning, but also looking at the economics of doing this. And I agree we can do it at scale. But I think we need to have a particular focus on that. So I would argue a blended approach between brownfield town centres, buying properties as part of this, but also looking at greenfield development where we can.
Thanks very much for that response. I just highly recommend that you look into Mid-Steeple Quarter in Dumfries. They're doing incredible work. It's community-led, but really supported by Dumfries and Galloway, and certainly a tremendous example in terms of communities bringing that town centre living, and that is using and identifying and doing the detective work to find the people who own the properties and buying them off them, and actually at a very interestingly low and usefully low for community price. Maureen, do you want to come in on this?
Not a lot to what John's just said, but can the place-based approach is and community-led work, absolutely fully support that. I know that many local authorities, including my own, we've got plans coming to a committee meeting tomorrow in South Lanarkshire about Hamilton Town Centre and a long-term development, that much of which is bringing Town Centre 11 right to the centre of that. So I think you know that is an approach that local authorities are already taking. But the complexity here, as John says, round about ownership of properties too. So,
about that, the complexity of ownership piece, is there something that we need to do, the Scottish Government could do to help understand who owns property better, more quickly to find that out?
I think the registration of ownership is not really the main major issue. We often deal with out of UK owners, yeah. And that does take time. But I referred to compulsory purchase orders earlier. Certainly in the last Parliament, there was a commitment to compulsory sales orders. And I think in England, they have compulsory renting orders. So there is an opportunity there to bring together all of that panoply of interventions by local authorities through legal means to try and stimulate people to, if they have empty properties, to bring them back into residential use with the help of RSL, certainly in local authorities and local charities.
Great, thanks for that. Callum, I invited you to speak on this. If you want to come in, that'd be
thank
great.
You, convener.
And anyone else who wants to.
I think the discussion there sort of reflects the fact there's a number of tools we have to address supply. So what John and Maureen have talked around, there's around empty homes and transformation of existing stock. There's new supply, new build, what we've talked about, and there's also the buying back from the open market. I think we need to be able to kind of lean on all of those tools as appropriate for landlords and for areas. But fundamentally, we do need new supply, and that requires building. We absolutely need to utilise transformation. Bringing city centres and town centres back to life is really important. Buyback, local authorities, ourselves, will do buybacks, particularly if it exists former right to buy stock. That happens tactically, that happens strategically all over Scotland. It will continue to do so. And they are really, really important, and I don't want to minimise that, but it will still come back to fundamentally the housing crisis will be solved by not just changing homes from one tenure to another, but by building more homes, as Jane said, of all tenures.
I have to call them marginal activities at the moment. That's not to underestimate their importance. Community-led homes, community-based housing, town centre first, acquisitions from the private sector are all really, really important. But at the moment, they are marginal to the overall supply of new homes. One of the big problems at the moment is in terms of that supply, our housing associations are having to reconsider their development programmes because of the risks involved, because of the reduction of government money, because of the uncertainty around all that. And that means that not only have we got housing crisis and we've got opportunities that we've just talked about, but we have a sector which is becoming more cautious and more uncertain and therefore having to reduce their risk in terms of their financial exposure. The placemaking aspect of housing associations is absolutely critical. Housing associations develop at scale in places and therefore they are anchor organisations and really critical organisations in terms of those overall places, wherever that may be, whether that's rural, urban, suburban, etc. The placemaking role needs scale. You can't make a place without scale. You know, a place can't be one or two homes. So that scale is really important, which brings us back to the need to deliver more homes to achieve that scale. And the final point I'd make is that is the one that Callum's just made, that all these aspects of the system, the housing system, are really important, and we'd like to see more of all those activities in terms of town centre first, acquiring existing vacant housing, placemaking and community-led approaches and more. But we can't do any of that unless we've got the scale of supply and the certainty of supply to support it.
I just, as a rural and islands MSP, I do want to say that two houses does, in some places, actually make a place. So it's all right. That's part of the challenge, isn't it? Where it's quite nuanced depending on where the need is and what we're looking to accomplish in terms of making place. Stephanie, you want to come in?
Thanks very much, convener. And if I can just start by putting on the record that I was a councillor at South Lanarkshire Council up until 2021. spoke quite a bit around the challenges so far, and I would be really interested to hear about any areas where the panel feel that there has been good progress towards plans set out in Housing 2040, and any good practice lessons that can be learned from that. In addition, I'd be interested in any areas where there have been challenges, where the panel are maybe able to reflect on how further progress could be achieved in those areas. Thanks.
Anybody want to come in on that? There must be some good progress. Sally, and then Jane.
Yes, thanks. Of course, there's been good progress. I mean, it was, as I said at the outset, hugely great progress to have it in the first place and to still have it and to have a commitment to it. And that in itself is good practice and worthy of support and worthy of complimenting. What we had initially with Housing 2040 was that vision, was that purpose, and discussion about the resources and capacity to go with it. That never amounted to exactly what we wanted to see in terms of the detail and the amount, and that's still outstanding and has been kind of further antagonised by the cut that we've seen. But what we did have at the outset, and for a few years, was certainty and confidence that there was a vision there that everyone could gather around, because everyone had been involved in producing it, and that everyone could develop, could retrofit, could acquire new homes, do what was needed to do to deliver a healthy housing market on the back of it. And what we've got now is a situation where that certainty and confidence has largely evaporated, I have to say. Things are much more fragile, and that, again, has been exacerbated by the cut that we've seen. So, yes, I would not want to devalue Housing to 2040 at the expense of the argument that a lot of us have here, which is the recent budget cut. It's still a great thing to have. It's much better to have it than not, but we're at risk of devaluing it by the actions that are being taken.
Jane.
I concur with that. I mean, there are 20 actions as part of the Housing 2040. We've done an exercise to monitor the delivery against some of those, and there are small areas where there has been work carried out. But I think the progress, and I think this is an exercise that probably needs to be done urgently, is to look at where the progress is and where the priorities are to unlock the barriers to housing supply to deal with the immediate issue that we've got for Scotland's population. And I agree all of the 20 actions remain relevant and they're important. And as advisors to the House 2040, we're committed to them. I think that there is a lack of urgency in understanding where are the blockers, as I've said earlier, through policy, where are the blockers through the resource, and where are the blockers through cross-directorate working. And I think if we can look into those fairly quickly, I think that would help. The National Strategy for Economic Transformation, their strategy, we are now looking at where housing sits as a contributor and inhibitor, and we welcome the work carried out through the Scottish Government and the Economic Directorate on that as well, because that's all about getting the understanding of housing across other areas in government that can influence it. So, yeah, let's not lose the ambition of the plan, but let's get practical on why it isn't delivering in the timescales that were originally set down, and why isn't it acting in the context of where we are with the economy and the housing and those things that we haven't got an agile. The thing is that we don't look at housing. We don't create an agile and inclusive housing ambition. I think we don't flex it. We've just got this on paper. I think it was before my time, but I think it was 5 years ago. This has to be a moving thing. This has to be a live ambition that is contextual.
Okay. I want to go there a little bit more, just when you talk about it, and it has to be alive. What would we see that would be happening differently?
I think because for example, when we look at housing, and if we look at housing and all of the different elements that impact it, which are very complex, both from the development cycle to the regulatory environment to the economic environment, where we create a housing policy or a housing ambition, we are sitting here, it feels sometimes we sit here a little bit surprised, going, gosh, we've got 100,000 deficit in houses. We shouldn't really be, because housing is a science. It relies on data, and Scottish Government creates, you know, good data. But what we are unable to do is to go, where is the flex if there is international conflict and we need to support refugees? What happens if the interest rates go up? You know, what happens when first-time buyers haven't got the products to get on the housing market, so we end up having, you know, an impact on first-time buyers? You know, all of these things, we always seem somewhat surprised by them, but we shouldn't, because always the economy has worked like that, always environment has worked like that, always we've needed housing. It's a basic human right. So I think, you know, if we could get some flex and intellect and more evidence and maybe horizon scan a little bit more on housing and plan out what we might be looking at and create flex. There's no flex in budgets. In fact, budgets are reducing. So we have no capacity to flex in budgets if we do need to deal with refugees. And I think that's part of the problem. The other thing is we don't understand who's building the houses in Scotland, where and where are those resilience points and where are the points where economically it's challenging. Labour, our industry sector, are saying to us that Labour is getting better. You know, I don't think Labour's going to be a big problem. Cost of materials is slightly better. But the problem is being able to build the houses that are needed.
Great. Thanks for going into that detail. It's actually helpful to kind of understand a bit more on that. I'm going to bring in Mark Griffin. Somebody mentioned budgets. Well, here we go.
Thanks, Sabina. Just before my questions, just remind everyone of my declaration of interest as a previous owner of a private rented property up to July last year. Lots of speakers have talked about budget, and I just wanted to ask what Munsey's views are on the impact of the 2040 vision on this year's housing supply programme budget cuts. How is that budget going to affect supply overall? How is it going to affect affordable supply? And finally, whether the ambition to deliver 110,000 affordable homes is realistic anymore. Jane?
Just on that, can I just state that on the budget, we have asked and formally written to be told what is the Scottish Government's view on where that budget is going to impact and how. We are concerned at the moment with a housing bill coming down the line that we're creating a bill. We don't actually know what the problem is, what's the solution we're trying to solve. We kind of do, but we don't know the detail because we don't understand where that budget is going to impact. So I think it's very important that we get that understanding. I appreciate it's in draft and we maybe need to wait till it goes through its full parliamentary process, but we need to understand where that is going to impact.
I think this is the core of the current kind of discussion, and we certainly at the last 2040 board had this discussion with the minister. What you need, and the level, and the word confidence has been used earlier, what you need in new build programmes is a level of certainty that you've got pipeline projects, that you've got momentum, you've got the key talent in place to actually do that within a local authority context. That includes planning. But also you've got key partnerships with RSLs and key partnerships with developers who will provide Section 75 contributions. So as soon as there's uncertainty around a budget, and this was the hope of Housing 2040, it would transcend 5-year cycles of budget deliberations and make that commitment to keep building houses over 20 years. So that's the issue here. Is that once you propose that kind of level of cut to an affordable housing supply budget, you're at risk of losing momentum. And it probably takes 1 to 3 years to get a project on the ground and built. So once you have that uncertainty around budget commitment, you then take that confidence away from the sector, you take momentum away. And I can only reflect on our own situation in Fife, which we're currently analysing and seeking a response from the government on. We are now holding up new build projects because we don't have certainty we'll have new subsidy budget in 24-25 because of the level of committed projects we already have in the strategic housing investment plan. And that's the case for all local authorities and many RSLs. So you will have that pause, slow down, take your foot off the accelerator and at a time when we need the reverse to happen. So one could argue that instead of coming down a gear, you need to actually go up two gears to try and tackle this housing emergency that we face.
If you want to come in.
Yes, just to demonstrate that further, we were building at the rate of about 7,500 social homes a year. Two or three years ago, even through COVID, that was holding up. We're building about 5,000 now, so there's 2,500 gap at the very least to keep up with the Housing 2040 ambitions. And that 2,500 does now represent the budget cut in number of homes per year. So the 26% budget cut in the budget before Christmas, Scottish Government budget before Christmas, equates to about 2,500 homes a year. So that's the kind of gap the ongoing gap that we're looking at. The other point I'd make is that, to come back to my point about certainty and confidence, RSLs, Registered Social Landlords, Housing Associations, depend on the private investment market, the private financial market, for roughly half, the money that they use to build a new home. So the government grant supplies about 50%, and then organisations go to the private lending market for the other 50%, and that can be pension funds, that could be banks and building societies. And so what's happening is that in a £3.4 billion programme, which is the government programme for the life of this parliament, housing associations probably bring in an extra £4 billion. So we'd estimate there was over £7 billion worth of housing supply money there. And that money coming into Scotland from all over the UK, from abroad, wherever else it comes. That money is now at risk because lenders can see there's less confidence, there's less certainty in the Scottish system, there's less confidence and certainty from government. And so we're at risk not only, well, we're not at risk because we are building far fewer homes than we need, and that's not due to change anytime soon. We're also at risk of losing the private sector money and the confidence and certainty behind that, that the financial markets bring into Scotland.
Okay, Callum.
Yeah. So to answer your question, Mark, we are absolutely at risk of not making the 2032 target. I think the fact that the Scottish Government, the Minister, has announced that he's bringing forward a review of that target suggests that there isn't that confidence that it can be met under the existing budgets. And again, talking about confidence in the sector, you know, we're talking about a budget cut for 24-25. Our expectation is this will be repeated deeper in the next Parliament, in the next budget. We all know what the kind of mid-year fiscal review, I think is the right title of it, looked at the kind of projections over the kind of the medium term. So we would expect this to be compounded in the following year's budget. Just building on what Sally's mentioned as well, we know that build costs are higher for social affordable housing, they increase every year. We're all aware that the government accepts that itself. There was a freedom information request that put that the build costs on average at 190,000. I know an Alacho and Sol's report in the summer last year said there could be costs between 200 and 300. But even accepting a build cost of £190,000 and the government roughly funding 55%, you know, that would be, we're losing 1,766 homes this year from that 196 million. That's gone. And that's compounding what John Blackwood's talked about the 22,000 homes leaving the private renting sector. So we're losing 22,000 homes in PRS and just shy of 2,000 in the social rent sector from this budget cut. I think for me, what's really interesting thing is here is actually how we can scale up. We can look at the total cost, even if we were to keep at £190,000 a unit and say we delivered 20 of the 110,000 homes, it would cost us £17 billion to deliver the 110,000 homes to build them. That's just over £9 billion cost to the government. And we don't really talk about that. We don't talk about the realism. Actually, is the government prepared to invest £9 billion in social and affordable housing? They absolutely should. But we don't talk about that within this parliamentary term, next parliamentary term and onwards. And what that means, because if, as Sally's just mentioned, if the government isn't willing to do that but still wants to reach that target, that means higher costs for tenants, because that's the only other way we can square the circle. So we need to be kind of realistic about actually what is the cost of delivery. And even accepting £190,000 per unit, it would cost £17 billion more to reach 110,000 homes by 2032.
Well, I think we started talking about it now. Thanks so much for bringing that up.
Jane. In terms of we've been talking about the sector, I think it's important to recognise that the draft budget, which is now a three-year consecutive reduction, I understand, about 40% over the last two financial years. I think that announcement, notwithstanding it's in draft, and I think all of the other regulatory pressures, economic pressures, the planning system, which has been well discussed today, I think representing the house building industry, it's fair to say that their vision of Scotland as a place to invest is now being impacted. We are seeing many house builders, you know, pulling out of sites, not interested, investing down south instead of in Scotland. That's a real problem for us as a country. And I think that there is a rebuild needed between kind of the relationships, you know, and the understanding of the value of the house building sector, because it's about social and economic contributions that it's making.
Thanks very much for that. Do you, the concerns you've raised there in terms of house builders pulling out and investing elsewhere, do you have evidence of that you could share with the committee?
If I can share it, I'm very happy to share that separately. Some of it is through, obviously, the, you know, the rent control. There are other sites that we can give you. There are others where we've had struggles with just financing through planning applications as well. So we can provide data to the committee separately if
that's
acceptable.
To know more about that. Okay. Mark, do you want to come back in?
Yep. I mean, if we make the assumption that the draft budget is passed in its current form and there is a cut, the million-dollar question is then how do we build the homes that we've all talked about are absolutely desperately needed with less money? Are there any other innovative finance models other than, you know, hard cash from government? Are there guarantees that government can provide to loan funding? You know, is there anything else government can be doing in the absence of hard cash to stimulate the house building that we know is required?
John. Nothing can replace a grant. Okay, in terms of building a house, I mean, most of it is loan funded based on tenants' rents. I think in local authorities it's about 53% funded through tenants' rents and borrowing to repay the interest, and 43% from 47% from the government grant. So if you replace grant, if you reduce grant and you replace it with other means, it's still a loan. You're going to have to pay that back. So that means higher tenants' rents over the short, medium, longer term. And I think in terms of affordability of rents, that's a critical consideration for every local authority leader and housing spokesperson. So it's going to be very difficult in an environment of cost of living pressures to justify to tenants why we need to actually borrow more on the HRA business plan, and more rents or higher rents would result. The answer is you simply cut back on your programme. And the argument just now is, do you blend it with more acquisitions in the private sector rather than building new homes? And I think many local authorities will look to do that now to reduce costs, because there's less grant available for acquisitions in any case. So I think that's going to be the result as strategic housing investment plans are reviewed every year, than keeping building at the same pace that we are, which is falling already. So it's going to fall even further. So that's the assessed outcome that we've made, certainly through a latch on.
Yep.
I'm going to refer back to the small and medium market in terms of house builders. I'll reiterate again how critical these are to the building of all tenure homes across Scotland. Since 2020, the economic environment has steadily become more difficult for the SME home builders. A combination of government budget cuts, COVID, Brexit, conflict in Ukraine, it's unprecedented uncertainty across the housing industry. But this has been most acutely felt by SMEs. They work to tighter margins with less available resources and are often able to plan ahead, dealing with the here and now. when we look at other things like inflationary pressures, costs of remediation of sites, planning costs, they will lack the resource also to research suitable options, and they rely on familiar funding sources. In Scotland, we are not supporting SMEs across these funding sources to be able to deliver the homes that we need. We are creating at the moment a piece of research that we have committed to share with the government, and with we will share it with committee on identifying who these SME builders are, where they're building, what rural and urban communities they're building on, the differentiation between brownfield and greenfield. This will give us a sense of where we can support, where we need to help. We'll also look at the demise of the SMEs. We know that there's probably in the last 5 to 10 years at least a 40% reduction in the SME builders across Scotland. That's a problem for us as well. So I think it's really important, and we have spoken to the government and minister to look at how we can invest and support SMEs through innovative finance.
Michael.
Just to come in and the point around innovative finance, and to echo the points that John has made, I think where innovative finance can deliver cheaper borrowing and that replaces existing higher cost borrowing, then that's obviously going to be a benefit, and that's going to drive some cost savings. But the point that John was making, that if that is seen as a replacement for public subsidy, then the direct impact of that is higher rents. Now, we already know that there is a significant upward pressure on rents this year. We're anticipating rent increases by social landlords of somewhere between 5 to 10%, and that's because of the costs that are already in those businesses. Anything that introduces a new additional cost will have that very direct impact on the level of rent. Okay.
And Sally.
Yeah, just to continue that point, we haven't talked about tenants very much, and clearly the reason we're all here, the reason Housing 2040 exists, is for people who need homes, whether they're tenants, whether they're homeowners, whether they're in the private rented sector. And Housing 2040 is about looking across the housing system, and that is really, really important because it is all interconnected. In terms of financing, we've spent, the housing sector spends, the registered social landlord part of the housing sector spends, or has spent, considerable amounts of time looking at other funding sources, and it always comes back to, are there funding sources that we haven't got at the moment that are cheaper, in other words, that charge less interest? Because as the point, as has been made already, housing associations have a very, very simple business model. Their sources of income are rent and private sector lending, and that's it. And they use that money, the rent and the private sector lending, to build homes, but critically to reinvest in the homes of existing tenants and those communities. And the more expensive the private lending is, then the less money there is to invest in those homes and those communities. At a time when the people in those homes and those communities are experiencing probably their worst ever financial situation, and that doesn't look to be ending anytime soon. So housing associations, as charities, as not-for-profit organisations, have to look primarily at the lives, the successes, the homes, the well-being of the people in their homes and communities. And they will always look to that first before looking for money that they might be able to get, but is more expensive and is going to have a deleterious effect on those homes and communities.
Okay, thanks very much for raising that point. Pam, you want to come in? Just brief supplementary.
Yeah, briefly, convener, just on the innovative solutions, obviously John Rogers, featured in the Scottish Housing News, looked at a few of the ideas around reform of the planning process, a reduction in land business and transaction tax, targeted support for first-time buyers, measures to help older homeowners downsize, and tax breaks for building low-cost, energy-efficient homes. So is there any thoughts around these ideas?
More detail around planning, if that would be helpful in terms of if we're looking at immediate and short-term kind of creating surge capacity as part of the solution. I mean, I think, first of all, I'd say that under the Scottish Government Transforming Places Together, the digital strategy for planning, we've already discussed today that the 43% cut in planning was across the digital. But we would advocate strongly the use of technology to free up planners' time. An example is a self-certifying system for whether or not an extension is permitted development, allowing councils to maybe focus more on other things. I think the reinstatement of the budget cut to planning would assist and quickly roll out projects if we could invest in that technology. I think another solution that we would be keen to explore is temporarily increasing the pool of self-employed planners or reporters. There's a lot of skills and talent out there to deal with the increase in the number of deemed refusals and major applications. And running the major applications, I think they could do in clear local developments, allowing councils to focus on housing applications. In addition, these people, this new resource could undertake site assessments following the receipt of the call for site submissions, and they may insist in delivering local plans as well. I think there may be some scope in looking at how councils could maybe collaborate. They may be doing this already, so forgive me, I'm not aware of everything that's going on. But if councils maybe collaborated and at a fundamental level, sharing of staff resources and expertise at more detailed level, for example, using a template site assessment methodology to accelerate considerations, I think that could help. I think we're always going to flag this, but you know, we want to put on the table that we ring fence planning fees, because the fees that are paid by developers are not going back into the planning regime. So then that's something that's very high on our agenda. And I think the last one that I'd probably put on the table is the introduction of a simplified development management approach to assist SMEs on sites on less than, say, 12 homes. To your point, Ariane, you know, these sites are very, very critical across communities as well. We have put these ideas to government for discussion. We see them as something that could be delivered quite quickly that we think would have some immediate impact on the planning system. Thank you.
Thanks very much for that. Did you want to come in? And then I'm going to move to Willie Coffey.
Just going to come in briefly, and it's important to talk about opportunities and positive things that can be done in this context. We've been co-chairing a cost pressures working group with government, which many people in this committee have participated in, and that's about to report on potential solutions to the cost pressures that we have in the home building industry overall. And there will be some recommendations around collaboration and risk sharing across the industry, land cost mitigation, and approaches to funding. So I think it's important to make the point that, yes, we are trying to look in a positive and creative and constructive way at solutions, as well as being really concerned about the challenges that we've got.
Thanks very much for that. We'll keep an eye out for that report. Mm. Willie Coffey.
Right, thanks very much, Convener. Despite some of the challenging messages being given today around the table, I think it's important to remember that Scotland has consistently built more social and affordable homes since 2007 than any other part of the UK, and continues to do so. And as an elected member for more years than I would care to remember, I can't help forgetting that we've lost 500,000 social rented homes in Scotland since 1979. And you could argue whether that has a legacy impact in the discussion we're having today. I certainly think it has had a substantial impact on that. So we reap what we sow from those years to this day, I think. But, Convener, I wanted to ask colleagues about the impact on homelessness services, and it was raised a couple of times. So I'd like to ask perhaps Michael and maybe Councillor Chalmers about this. What more do we need to do to... I beg your pardon, Councillor Chalmers, I'll get closer to the microphone. I just wanted to ask your views on the impact of homelessness and the potential rise in this. I think you mentioned a report from Harriet Watt that's perhaps due, that suggested that there could be an increase of a third, I think you said, Maureen. But I wanted to first ask Michael his views, because the regulator was giving us these stark warnings about the impact of homelessness in the years to come, and how we should build that or try to build some further protections into the housing to 24 strategy?
I think certainly we've highlighted just before Christmas in an update to our earlier homelessness thematic that we are now seeing systemic failure impacting on a number of local authorities. And we await the publication of the Scottish Government figures at the end of this month that will update the position on homelessness up until the end of September last year, and we anticipate those numbers deteriorating significantly when we see that, and that would certainly reflect what we've seen as we engage with councils through the course of the last year. And the real challenge here is back to supply. There are not adequate numbers of homes becoming available to be able to meet the demands that are placed on many local authorities through people becoming homeless. It's now the position where we are starting to see a real risk of statutory failures to provide temporary accommodation or statutory failures around the unsuitable accommodation order becoming endemic in some areas. And I think that's where there needs to be this immediate focus on how to resolve that challenge. And John has spoken about 1 to 3 years as a time horizon. And I think that seems a reasonable time horizon to see how do we turn around the position that we're in, where we have, you know, over 15,000 households in temporary accommodation for longer periods of time than we have had before. And I think it is about prioritising available homes and available resources to deal with that. It will be very difficult for local authorities to move to realising the ambitions of rapid rehousing while we have that kind of very significant backlog of households in temporary accommodation.
Councillor Chalmers, could you offer that perspective?
Much as Michael was saying, our numbers are increasing all the time, and certainly where some local authorities were making really good progress on rapid rehousing and beginning to turn that round in the last year, that has slowed right down, and we're seeing 15, 16, 18, 20% homelessness within local authorities. And as Michael said, I think we've got around about half of our local authorities who are at risk of breaching their statutory obligations, and that's not where local authorities want to be. The research that I referred to was Heriot Watt University. They published a study indicating that core homelessness will increase by a third over the next 2 years. And therefore, you know, the announcement around the affordable housing supply programme just cuts right across that, you know, in terms of how can we, you know, how can we, we're not dealing with what we've got right now, never mind what's coming up ahead of us at the end of the month and in the slightly longer term. I think it's one of the reasons why some local authorities have declared a housing emergency. It's also why we at COSLA have brought together the special interest group to try and find some of those solutions. I know Stephanie asked earlier on round about what's working well. There are things that are working well, and there was good practice round about this as well. But it's about all the challenges, the complexity of the challenges that are coming at local government at the moment. Are really, you know, we've got, for example, our Ukrainian guests, who I think we've got round about 20,000 people who are waiting to be permanently housed. And, you know, every local authority is trying to do that alongside our core homelessness figures. John mentioned earlier on about private landlords. We're seeing an increase in the number of people who are opting out of being a private sector landlord, and that pressure all comes in to local government. So it's that multitude of pressures, and we don't see, we just see the figures going up. And the only real solution to that is to have more homes. And I think we've been saying that over the last few months. We really do need more homes for people.
Maureen, just to come back on that.
I'm just having a struggle hearing you. That's
right. I'm just trying to get as close to this as I can and shout. you also mentioned in your initial remarks about human protection schemes being important. Do you see there being an increasing reliance on that to try to help that problem at that level?
The difficulty we've got with human protection schemes is, I mean, I think there is not a, I mean, if I go, if there's leaders' meetings or our community wellbeing board meeting, no one has said anything. We want to welcome people here and we want to support them and support them well. That's a given. I think it's the lack of planning and the lack of a planned approach. So if you take, for example, the Syrian resettlement scheme, there was lots of planning, there was lots of discussion. When people arrived, there was a team right round about them, the school was ready to receive the children, all of that work was done in preparation. Now the numbers were quite different, obviously. I think what's happened in the last couple of years, as you all know, is the numbers of people arriving quite quickly. And you will be aware that the welcome accommodation for our Ukrainian guests is coming to an end, and the move on will finish at the end of this financial year, but we've still got people who are looking for housing. So those schemes and the complexity of them, both the UK schemes and the Scottish Government schemes, are putting that pressure on us together, and there's no coherence across all of that. We really desperately need everybody. And we've made that case to both UK Government and Scottish Government, UK Government together to say, let's get together and work some of this out, because it would help local government prepare for, plan and properly support people who come to live here as new Scots.
OK, thanks very much, Maureen. John, I think you indicated you wanted to contribute.
Yeah, I used the word survival over the next 3 years, and I think I'm not using that word lightly. I think it's going to be really difficult to meet all of the homelessness demands that are coming on local authorities. I mean, I'm currently getting lots of letters from MSPs about hotels in Fife to say, what's going to happen to these people? And I say, well, they're going to be homeless, you know, because there's no other accommodation resources available for me to try and get a planned approach to resettlement. I think the other issue is there are a number of solutions to this over the next 1 to 3 years, and we've been in real deep conversation with civil servants around short-term housing supply. And there was a short-term housing supply group set up, which I think has yet to fully, finally report. But it mirrors a lot of the report that Solis and Alacho produced last July in terms of recommendations. So there are solutions out there, but it needs investment. So keep building, keep buying, bring down empty homes, both in the public and private sector. That's what it's about, to increase capacity over the next 1 to 3 years. So the solutions are there. It's just, well, how do we actually implement them? And that's the resource issue. It's both human resources, money, and accommodation. And that has to come together at the right pace in each local area across Scotland, because it's not all the same. So every local authority has a rapid rehousing transition plan. That's the vehicle for doing it. So we just need to be able to actually resource it properly and actually allow local authorities with local partners to implement those solutions at pace.
Thank you, John. Time for my second. Yep. Just to ask perhaps a broader question to the panel about overall quality standards in our new builds. Are they fit for purpose? Do they meet the demands and the needs of the 21st century? Brian was talking earlier about the green impact and designing our homes to be greener. There's digital requirements too, that homes should be digitally enabled. And in this committee, you've probably heard us discussing about materials that are used to build our houses. And we're talking about cladding principally for higher buildings. But should we be thinking about adequacy of good materials in our build standards? Are they fit for purpose, really, for the modern home? Jane, would you care to offer a view on broad quality standards and new build quality?
Well, I think we need to recognise that the home building sector is already a heavily regulated industry that goes through vigorous verification sign-off procedures through building control. In addition, new build, I think it's important to recognise, come with stronger consumer protection in place, you know, through the provision of the consumer codes and oversights by the New Homes Quality Board. You'll maybe be aware of that. I think that it's fair to say that home builders are facing kind of significant change in building standards as Scotland strives to meet, quite rightly, an ambitious net zero target. I mean, we're looking at 32% reduction in operational carbon emissions, a ban on gas boilers from April 2024, and the development of the Scottish equivalent passive house standard as well. all of our industry members recognise and support the need to do more on this and are committed to achieving what is practical at the earliest opportunity, but we must be recognised as being in the context of new build homes representing a tiny part of the housing stock, and we've talked about that earlier in committee, and the existing housing stock must be tackled as well to create the meaningful impact of reducing carbon emissions as well. So I think, you know, without going into detail, we are happy to go into detail on another session, but I think as a regulated industry sector and a commitment from the sector to create the highest standards, yes, I think is the answer.
Carlo?
Just to probably add to some the question from Pam earlier, we talked about the accessible homes and people with disabilities. You know, we're currently undergoing, or just concluded, a consultation for housing for varying need in Scotland. So that's been a long time we've been waiting on that consultation, looking at how we improve kind of accessibility of homes and new build homes in Scotland. And that's really welcomed by the whole sector. However, it comes back to the fundamental point around the kind of cost of delivery. We're all ambitious to have more accessible homes. We'll think that kind of the housing for varying need guidance is dated and needs to reflect actually the kind of needs of people in their home in Scotland today. And I think that's a constant. The housing sector and the government working together could continually review all housing standards and could stress them and push them to whether it's an energy efficiency, whether it's space size, whether it's digital connectivity. That's the job that we all do. But the thing that we are missing is a full appraisal of the cost of doing that. Because if we are conscious about the actual cost of doing that, then we can make choices around the pacing of that, when we implement that. Not that we don't want to implement that, but we have to be just conscious. If that's going to cost so much money, then is that the priority for this time, or do we focus our time somewhere else? So I think the sector is well-versed and is used to that constant change and that constant flux. We're always working to new standards. It's never settled. But what we need to have is a clarity around the costs of delivering that and a prioritisation. Does that come first, or do we focus on, for example, as we've talked today, on the housing emergency in front of us?
Thanks, Carl. Any other views on quality?
Social homes have to meet incredibly rigorous and high standard qualities, which the regulator oversees. And again, that's one of the reasons why lenders are so attracted to the sector, because the quality is so high and in perpetuity is so high. And 9 out of 10 tenants under kind of regulatory survey are satisfied with their homes and services. So there is a broad understanding and a broad picture where standards are very high and tenants and communities are happy with what they get. The contradiction in all of this is that standards and quality is not finite and is not it continues to grow, to develop, because there are always new issues and new requirements, not just for retrofit, which is huge, but also for modern standards around digital connection. And then things that come out of the left field, if you like, damp and mould, rack, fire safety, all of which are absolutely vital. They might come at you from, you know, left field, but they're absolutely vital. They might not be planned, but we have to do them. And the contradiction is that all that costs. And so the costs of doing that have a direct impact on the money available to build homes and to do what's needed to maintain existing homes. There have been some conversations, kind of under the radar, if you like, about whether the Scottish quality standard could be amended for acquiring homes. So not building new homes and not retrofitting necessarily, but to acquire homes on the open market to become social housing, to meet the housing needs we've talked about. Can we reduce the expectation of the Scottish quality standard? Now, that you know, raises all kinds of questions, which we won't go into here. But there are ways of looking at this which might be helpful and positive. But overall, I would say we don't want to lose the quality of homes that we've got, but there is a cost to that.
Thank you, Sally. No other views. Thank you very much.
All right, thanks very much. We're now going to go back online and bring in Stephanie Callaghan with another question.
Thank you very much, Convener. We've heard already that implementing Housing to 2040 vision includes linkages with a range of other policy areas, such as energy efficiency in the planning system. We've also heard comments around health and social care, mental health education as well there, and addressing depopulation, within the deserved due care policy. So I'm wondering if anyone's able to say any more on how the Scottish Government can look at joining up its policy actions to achieve the Housing to 2040 vision and any opportunities to build on good practice or improve this. Thank you.
Anybody got any thoughts about joining? I mean, Jane, in a way, you've kind of touched on it quite a bit already to some degree. But yeah, come on in.
I can't stress strongly enough, having worked and collaborated with government and welcomed those conversations, the importance of getting, if you like, smart working across Scottish Government. We're aware of the depopulation action plan that was released, I think it was on Friday. Just to say that document mentions housing, I think, multiple, like 300 times. But there was no consultation with us, or were we aware of it, even as Housing 2040 advisers. I'm not criticising the report or the importance or undermining the importance of the report. The point I'm making is we're not going to get this right if we don't collaborate. If we're creating action plans over there that are tackling depopulation, which is a big issue, and we're not consulting and using evidence and data to inform that action plan from the sectors that impact depopulation, we're not going to get this right.
Anybody else on that? Joined up approach? No? Okay. I'm going to now bring in Marie McNair, who's got... Maureen, do you want to come in? All right, great.
It was really just around health and social care. I think in the same way, we know that... for example, I've had meetings with some of the long-term care organisations where end-of-life and kind of palliative care needs are not necessarily being met within a housing context. And we know that that's about joining all of that up to make sure that we hear from those kinds of specialist organisations around the needs of people they're working with. And some of the local authority projects that are coming forward just now that are housing-led solutions to long-term care are perhaps some of the solutions around that. So it's again about bringing together where there's good practice and listening to those organisations that can inform the way forward. You could say the same round about care experienced young people and about veterans too. It's about listening to those groups and making sure that that's built into planning.
Thank you very much for that. I'm now going to bring in Marie McNair, and then we've got questions. I'm going to go to a rural direction with Brian Whittle, and then we do have a series of questions on the cost of living, tenant protections. I hope you bear with us. We're going to go over a bit more. We need your good attention and thoughts. It's really helpful for a bit longer. So, Marie.
Thank you, convener. Before I start that, I've just gone to my registered interest. Up until 2022, I was a local authority councillor in West Lanarkshire. John, how well are the Scottish Government and those partners responsible for working to achieve the aims, 2040 aims, involving communities, tenants and residents in the delivery plans?
And there certainly is a commitment in Housing 20 to work with all residents and tenants within communities to inform a number of issues about different housing mixes, infrastructure, making sure we don't build houses without shops, access to shops. Health centres are very important, obviously. So I think that commitment underpins the 2040 strategy. And certainly a tenant representative on the Housing 2040 board from one of the networks in Scotland. So that commitment is actually around the table and is voiced. I think when we come to local working with communities around some of the housing pressures, I think there's a lot that we can do to actually get out public messaging about that and to get tenants and applicants and residents to understand some of the issues and consequences of not having enough homes in the area. I was at a meeting of community council just a few months ago where the question was around the falling school role in the primary school. And the obvious thing from a housing professional is we'll build more houses. We don't want that because of X. So there's a lack of appreciation about some of the issues that affect the community, but actually building new homes in that local community and the benefits that can bring. So, yeah, there is that commitment, but I think there's a lot more that can be done, particularly at the very local level, about informing people about how the housing system works and what benefits it can bring to local communities.
Do you feel outcomes have improved for residents, tenants, and the community?
I think if you just look at homelessness and people getting housed, although we've talked about a huge backlog, people are being housed through the housing system and housing associations and local authorities. So for those people, the outcomes are very much improved. Less empty homes in the area is another key issue for local authorities and housing associations. And I think you can see evidence of local authorities and RSLs reducing the number of voids that they are managing. So getting your own house in order is a benefit to the community because there's less empty homes and more residents paying council tax in those areas. So, you know, there's a whole load of benefits, whole host of benefits to taking these short-term actions that I talked about earlier, because it's not just local authority politicians and officers that are saying this, it's actually local community representatives as well. So you need to hear that voice.
Okay. Anyone else want to come in? Sally?
Yeah, I mean, housing associations, it's built into their kind of DNA that they have to, they do consult with and involve tenants. Most housing associations were set up by local people who were looking for housing at that time, roughly most of them 50 years ago. And the majority of them are still there. They're very resilient organisations. And as charities and not-for-profit organisations, their sole purpose is to provide good homes, decent homes for people who need them and help those people stay in them. And you can only do that by involving the people who need those homes and helping them stay in them. So the housing association model is such that not only do they provide great homes, but they are organisations which will help you stay in your home, whatever that might take, up to a point, for as long as you need it, and then to help you move on to other homes. So that all requires very, very close involvement and engagement, and it's absolutely part of their fabric.
Absolutely. Anyone else before I hand back? Callum, sorry.
Thank you. This was just to add, finally, I'm actually very encouraged by the kind of returns we always see to the Scottish housing regularness. We see the high levels of satisfaction in the social housing sector are demonstrable year after year. We see people are kind of really satisfied with the service that they receive, the quality of the home. And equally, I think from the service we see in the private rented sector, you do see real satisfaction with kind of rented accommodation across Scotland. And I think that's something to be applauded as we're reflecting on successes. I do think we are at a tipping point. I think there's risk around that declining over future years. I think the regular themselves have reported on the increasing number of deficits that we see amongst RSLs. I think that when any organisation gets into financial challenges, then there's an understandable need to focus more inwards and manage that rather than focusing outward. And I think that is a risk that the sector is likely to face over the next few years. But fundamentally, the social rented sector and, I'd say, the private rented sector are delivering kind of a quality of home that actually tenants and customers are actually really happy with, and think that is borne out by the data.
Thank you.
Thanks very much for that. I'm now going to bring in Brian Whittle.
Thank you, convener. I'll be as brief and concise as I possibly can here. We've touched on migration from an inward migration perspective and how the housing market has to deal with that. But there's also the issue of migration within country. We have a significant issue of migration from rural to urban. We also have a surprise to me the extent of the migration from west to east. And obviously that has an impact on putting pressures on housing. And specifically around the rural, I'm going to come to you in a minute, Jim, because I know you talked about SMEs who are predominantly those who build houses in rural communities. But that migration is leading to reduction in services or the reduction in the ability to deliver services, which means there's less people there, which means it seems to be an ever decreasing circle. So in the 2040 paper, does it take into account, come in, does it take into account this migration and one of the key issues that has been mentioned a lot is the lack of housing. I'm going to the lack of housing, appropriate housing within the rural community to keep people within those communities.
It's back to that place-based approach, isn't it? And kind of, there's a rural housing plan too, and maybe John will come in with a wee bit more detail on that, but that was kind of looking at trying to maintain that place-based approach and making sure that there's housing there. But as you say, if there's a local school and people are moving away, then it puts all the services at risk. So trying to maintain that place is a priority. But maybe John will come in and give a bit more detail of the...
I'm actually going to a Fife Housing Partnership meeting this afternoon to talk about a specific rural housing forum to be set up in Fife, because we've got that mix of city, urban and rural. So if you look at our last phase of new build programme that we had, just what we call the phase three, most of the houses were built in rural North East Fife, because we recognised there was a deficit there. And that helps people access or keep jobs locally, also helps families keep children at a local primary school to keep it viable. So although we tend to focus, if you look at the homeless population, it's mainly city and urban, but we have to look at solutions across all of the geographies of Scotland, not just in the bigger conurbations. You made mention, I mean, I'm part of the Edinburgh South East Scotland City Deal Housing Partners Group. And, you know, we've recognised that this region is the fastest growing region in Scotland. Why? Why are people being attracted to this region? It's mainly economic opportunity, I would argue. So there is a need to look at housing in a rural context, but also, you know, stimulating local business and also, you know, social enterprise in these areas. But it's also about keeping the infrastructure viable for the local authorities and others to invest in. So absolutely, rural housing has to be one of our priorities going forward.
So as I mentioned, Jane, I think it's SMEs that are the predominantly the builders within rural communities. And I mean, it's all connected. The connectivity is hugely important. But there's also a cost associated with building in rural areas. Do we need to look at how we incentivise builders? Because at the end of the day, builders need to make... You know, you need to turn the coin. Do we need to be incentivising to build in rural?
Well, I welcome the question. And just to your earlier point you asked about the Housing 2040 Action 6 is very much focused on how we support and deliver housing in rural rural economies. So, yes, it is in Housing 2040, clearly. But I think, first of all, I'd start off saying that we have the Rural and Islands Housing Action Plan. I think whilst that covers a lot of different areas, it doesn't really acknowledge or support the private sector role in that, and ultimately I think fails to take an all-tenure approach to rural housing delivery and the interdependencies between private and public delivery. I think we also need to be cognizant that rural housing delivery is historically low. I think we probably know that, and it's about 27% below the 2007 home building levels. Build costs, to your point, are higher, as you'd expect in rural areas, 10 to 25% due to the scarcity of labour, skilled trades and delivery costs. And for remote, really remote rural and island developments, that can go up to 50 to 75% higher for developing than what would be in urban areas. The other problem you've got is in what we've seen from the report that we're creating, average processing time for rural housing developments across rural planning authorities was 42.9 weeks in 22-23 and 14.1 week for minor developments. So that's interesting. I think we've got to look at that in the mix when we're looking at barriers. And I think the permitted development rights as well for conversion of agricultural properties consulted on and adopted into increasing housing, there's potential opportunities there for SMEs. So to answer the question, yes, there's a huge opportunity here to look at subsidising. But I think the other thing that we are, and I'm going to revert back to our housing needs research that just came out, one of the things you've got to look at is are we understanding the housing needs in terms of the economic opportunity and supporting the economic development? I think probably a current one to refer the committee to is the Highlands, is the Greenport, which was looking to create 10,000 jobs in that economy, yet the local development plan doesn't acknowledge the housing that's going to be needed to support the staffing. And let me be very clear, this is not just the housing industry on this across rural. This is other industry sectors, the tourism sector. A lot of industry voices are saying, you know, the economy isn't working because there isn't the houses. And I think the rural, how we look at our rural and supporting our SMEs to build there is going to be critical to kick-starting housing supply.
Thanks for that very comprehensive response. I just want to bring in Stephanie Callahan, who has a brief supplementary on this.
Thanks very much, Convener. And it's kind of moving back from rural to urban to a degree and picking up on a couple of things that were said yesterday. And I'm sorry, my Alexa's gone off in the background. Hopefully it's not very loud for other people. So at North Lanarkshire Council, they've taken a decision to deal with the high-rise tower blocks because they have residents that are really not keen to be living there. So despite them actually building 5,000 affordable homes, it looks likely that they might actually end up with 1,000 fewer homes in the area. And I'm not sure whether this is a wider issue that impacts other local authorities too. But what I'm really interested in is, do we need to be thinking much more about creative ways to breathe new life into housing that's not currently attracting residents? Thanks.
John.
Yeah, I'm aware of that specific decision within the context of the HRA business plan in North Lanarkshire. I think most other local authorities have said that tower blocks are sustainable. They need investment, and clearly there's an awful lot of investment going in over the years in cladding and other improvements. But they are very popular with tenants and residents, high ownership in many of them through right to buy. So I think in terms of other types of housing where local authorities are looking at the economic viability to bring them up to the SHQS, Scottish Housing Quality Standard, we're always very cautious about proposing demolition to elected members and local communities. But sometimes that's the only solution because they're just not viable over 30 years. But there are types of housing where if you improve them, particularly older housing, older sheltered housing, you can actually make them viable. So, yes, we've got to look at the existing stock and look at the investment requirements and look at the opportunities for extending their lifespan. So that's part of the solution to housing shortages in Scotland.
Okay. Anybody else on that one? Nope. All right. Good. Okay. So thanks so much for that. So that concludes our questions on the Housing to 2040. But before we finish, as I mentioned, we do have a few questions, and I know they're not necessarily relevant to all of you, on the Cost of Living Tenant Protection Scotland Act 2020 regulations. So hopefully we can get through those quite quickly. Let's see how we get on. So I'll start. I'd be interested to hear, obviously, for those of you who this is relevant to, if you agree in the principle that the Scottish Government needs to use its powers to amend the rent adjudication system to smooth the transition away from the rent cap. Yeah. Callum.
Yeah. Thank you, Convener. So, yeah, at Shard Institute Housing, we understand the case for introducing the amendments after an 18-month freeze for rent in the private rented sector. There's obviously a risk that tenants could be subject to significant rent increases once they come down. So we understand the principles. I think there's still a lot of concerns around the approach, though. While understanding the concern to look after tenants, and even the process to get to this point is an incredibly short consultation period set out by the Scottish Government. As a respondent to the consultation, you know, we had a matter of days, weeks over the Christmas period to really kind of respond to the proposal, which, you know, given the scale of the kind of impact, it doesn't seem sufficient enough. Given we're in mid-February and these proposals will be enacted in April, it doesn't give us really sufficient time to communicate to landlords and tenants around what the impact will be. I think the calculations are probably much more confusing than existing arrangements, understandably, but the band with it when 6% seems to be acceptable and then tapered off up to a cap, there's complexity in that, it's confusing. And I think fundamentally looking at the Scottish Government's business plan analysis of this, it seems like a very modest impact they expect from these proposals, only at a high level, only 600 cases coming to Rent Service Scotland, which I would suggest it seems incredibly modest given the scale of the kind of private rented sector in Scotland. So understandable intentions, but I think there's a lot of questions around that. And I appreciate we're only weeks away from this being enacted.
Thank you very much. Anyone, anything more to add? We do have questions that will build on this. So John Blackwood, yep.
You can imagine we've got some comments on this,
yes,
this
exactly.
particular issue. So hopefully we can contribute to I think what's been really interesting about the discussion so far is that there's two key messages. One is we need more housing in Scotland, but also landlords and investors need confidence. And that is more so true than in the private rented sector. We've got landlords saying we need confidence to be able to continue to operate our lettings businesses and provide valuable homes for people here in Scotland. And the concern that they've had and we have as an organisation is, whilst we welcome the measures in the sense of a transition away from the emergency measures, we were promised that emergency measures would only be short term, that we would come out of that. That doesn't look likely now with the transitionary measures being proposed and put in place. Our concern largely is that the measures are so confusing. They're incredibly confusing for tenants as well as landlords. I don't know how either party is going to be able to understand what they need to do come the 1st of April when it comes to increasing rents. From the research we've been doing with our members, that they're saying already 1 in 10 properties are no longer financially viable in the private rented sector. Now, that's dramatic. So they are saying that actually the outgoings are far in way of any income that's actually coming in through rental income. So they're really concerned about the viability of these businesses going forward. And we've got, at the moment, over 50% of landlords saying within the next 5 years they would expect to get out of the sector. So that consumer confidence from landlords' perspective in the private rented sector, I think, has gone. And we need to try and rebuild that and sustain that so that we've got a sustainable private rented sector for the future too. Affordability is key. And one thing I do want to emphasise is, of course, we don't want rents to be unaffordable to tenants. Landlords don't want that either, because it means that ultimately they won't be able to pay the rent if that rent goes up out of control. So we do need to look at bespoke measures to be able to stabilise rents for the future and at the same time give that all-important confidence to those landlords and investors. We were reading earlier how the rent cap has already damaged investment prospects here in Scotland from institutional investors wanting to come into Scotland. And the same applies for, of course, private individuals who, quite frankly, can't afford to continue to be landlords in Scotland. So we need to urgently look at that so that we are providing valuable housing for those who are in need. And I have a concern that really nobody understands the measures. It's so complicated. And I think we've got chaos coming come the 1st of April.
Thanks very much for that. Pam, you want to come in with a very brief supplementary, please?
No, convener. It's actually my question. It fits in nicely in this one. Thank you. Thank you very much, John, for obviously that response. You know, you've spoke about landlords needing confidence to keep letting, and obviously we've spoke about today that there is a big issue right now with supply of housing. But Maureen, you actually also mentioned earlier there that people are opting out of being private landlords. So my question is around that kind of private landlords, but also the rent cap. I mean, the Scottish Property Federation warned that the Scottish Government's rent cap has created affordability crisis, which we're obviously speaking about today. Rents in Scotland have reportedly increased more than 14% despite the cap, and Scotland is the only part of the United Kingdom which the number of properties sold by landlords has gone up. Last year, a report published by the Scottish Property Federation showed rent controls and political uncertainty were impacting investors, which today, John, you have spoke a little bit about. So appetite to fund and deliver to build homes in Scotland, and these regulations obviously are increasing uncertainty. So my question is around, and is increasing investor appetite a more sustainable way to drive rents downwards in the long run? Or basically, do we have to, like you've said, relook at what's coming out? The measures are uncertain, and the fact that basically looking at the measures, they're very unclear as well.
Are very unclear, but importantly, we need to look at the bigger picture. How can we get more housing? How can we increase housing, rented accommodation in Scotland? The private rented sector has a role to play in that, and I'm keen for it to deliver on that. So how can we expand on that? We have to understand that the private rented sector is made up of a wide range of different players, investors. So you're talking about institutional investors there. The majority we know of private landlords in Scotland just own one or two properties. They're not business people, they're not investors, they're not banks or financial institutions. They're ordinary people like you or I who are finding that through the cost of living crisis, their costs have gone up as well. And they're saying this is so unfair that other businesses in Scotland are able to increase their costs accordingly, but we aren't. We can't pass on our increase in costs to our customers, who are ultimately the tenants here. And that's a real concern for landlords, to say it's not a level playing field. But equally, they feel the government's not interested in them. They're saying, you know what, actually, we think the government wants to get rid of us. And that's fine, we can go and invest elsewhere, but where are tenants going to find that valuable housing? We already know that there's a lack of accommodation in the social housing sector, so where else are they going to go to find a rented home? And that's the concern, longer term. So we all can sit back and say, yes, the figures are showing us, we can see from our research, probably last year in the region of 22,000 properties were lost to the private rented sector. One in 10 are no longer financially viable. What does all of that mean? Well, it means over the next few years, more and more landlords are going to sell, which is going to put more and more pressure on local authorities to be able to try and deliver through their homelessness services.
John, you spoke about earlier on that you know, in the next 5 years, we see this sector really suffering, that we really need to do something. Obviously, you know, government wants to put these rent caps in, but private landlords, like you've said, there's people that own one or two properties. Their mortgages have gone up. You know, they're in a crisis as well in their own way. So, you know, we have to have that happy medium. So what do you see the solution being here that, you know, with obviously the rent cap coming in? And where do you see reform or solution is, you know?
I think there's probably a form of solutions. And even going back to a discussion earlier about bringing empty homes back into use, we have landlords who are saying actively, you know, we would still invest in the private rented sector. But these are the fiscal issues that we have, that it's from a taxation point of view, it's very difficult to continue to invest in the private rented sector. Additional dwelling supplements, all of these different costs add on to what the landlord needs to pay out in order to deliver or invest in new accommodation. So they're saying it's no longer financially viable. Even new investment isn't viable. So could we do something with those landlords who are prepared to provide affordable accommodation? Yes, I think we could. And I think the government could look at innovative solutions to be able to fix what we need as a short-term need of finding new accommodation within the next 1 to 3 to 5 years. So that's part of the solution, but there's this overall feeling from private landlords is that actually the government wants to get rid of them, that they don't want them to be operating in the sector at all. And that's evident in the legislation that's coming out from the Scottish Parliament, as well as that's been led through policy by the Scottish Government. So we need to address that, look at that. And I have said for a long time to ministers, what we need is the Scottish Government to say this is our vision for the private rented sector in Scotland. This is how it should look. This is who should be operating within it, and this is who it should serve. Those are the discussions that we need to have. And for many, they'll be difficult conversations to have. And equally for those individual landlords that have invested, as I say, they might just have one or two properties in the sector, many of them will be looking to exit the sector for a number of reasons. How can we stop that property leaving the rented sector? That's what we should be looking at. So we were talking earlier about local authorities having power to buy back some of these properties. That's been a problem for many landlords to sell to local authorities. They've been coming to us saying, I've got a sitting tenant, I can't afford to keep them anymore because my outgoings are much in excess of the rental income. So therefore, I want to get rid of this investment. I want to no longer be a private landlord. So they're thinking, I don't want to evict a tenant. I've got a good tenant paying the rent. They're trying to go to the local authority, and the local authority is saying, I'm sorry, we'll only buy it if the property is empty. That does not make sense. And I'm pleased now with Scottish Labour and the Scottish Government, they're looking at ways to buy these properties with tenants in situ from private landlords. So there's all these issues that we need to be looking at to be able to sustain a private rented sector for the future. And we're not having these conversations. We need to be having them.
Maureen, you mentioned that obviously people are opting out being private landlords. Do you have any kind of insight into this?
First of all, you know, the private sector is vital to the function of local housing provision, local housing system. We need that because when people come forward, they need their housing options, and that might look different for different people. So a good, vibrant private rented sector is important. I think some local authorities are taking steps. So I know, for example, one local authority took steps to change that approach, to look at kind of, you know, if a private sector landlord was saying, I don't really want to do this, approach the council. There are kind of wee sticky bits around about that, and I think it's about working some of that through. But that was a kind of open offer if people wanted to do that. And I think that did increase the approaches from people locally. Different local authorities are taking different approaches, but those are the good practice bits we want to bring into our special interest group. Really, obviously, I'm aware that rent increases have caused a lot of pressures for people, and we need to get the right solution for that. But I think, just going back to what Callum was saying, not sure where this particular proposal came from and the thinking behind it. And it does seem quite complex, so keen to understand more and look at how that can be explained a wee bit more. And also, we do think that an automatic right to adjudication is critical for tenants in whatever system we bring forward. But we do need a good system. We do need to try and protect rents for people, particularly in a cost of living crisis. But we also need to think about that kind of whole process for folk and make it a wee bit simpler for people.
So before I bring in next people, please succinct answers, because we really have gone over time quite considerably and we were hoping that this was going to be quick. So also colleagues, maybe have a look at the questions you've got before you that you want to ask and see if maybe they've already been answered sufficiently. So Jane, you wanted to come in.
Yeah, just a point on this. This needs to be looked at in the bigger picture of where we are on housing supply. Ultimately, a piece of regulation like this, which is very confusing. It's obviously looking at the forthcoming housing bill to deliver its next iteration. I think with the draft budget and the forthcoming UK budget, I think that housing bill, I think, as I've said earlier, it needs to be revisited. I think this has weakened evidence that this regulation on the emergency regulation and the proposed rent cap is ultimately going to affect housing supply and Scotland being seen as a place to invest. And I think there are data points to evidence that.
Thanks very much. I'm going to bring in Willie Coffey now.
Thanks very much, convener. The issue about the numbers of landlord registrations was asked and answered in the chamber recently in the last few weeks. And the figures that we had to date suggest that the numbers actually had increased between August 2022, November 2023. I know that contradicts what John was saying a moment ago, but once we see the figures, we'll know the full picture. But that question was asked and answered in the chamber. But let's not forget, convener, that the reason for this is to try to prevent falling over the cliff edge into this unaffordability issue and to create more homelessness. So simple question is the 6% and the 12% figures that are being proposed, are they fair and reasonable? Do colleagues have a view, the lower limit of 6% and the upper limit of 12%? Do colleagues have a view on whether they are fair and adequate? John.
I think you know what I'm going to say. But regardless, I think we need to look at, for many landlords, they haven't increased their rents for a considerable number of years. So that's the kind of the norm within the sector. Rightfully or wrongfully, that's the way they've been operating. So when the cost of living crisis came along, of course, everybody's affected by that. And they suddenly realised, actually, I don't have enough money coming in rent anymore to pay these outgoings. So therefore, the option to increase rent wasn't an option anymore. They had to do it. And of course, it was frozen. Then it was restricted to 3%. Our research from members, when we asked them, well, what do you need it to be in today's money as a rent increase on your tenant's rent? And they were saying it's around about 18%, in excess of 18% is what they feel they would need to get to break even. And of course, that includes regulation costs, tradesperson's costs, and of course, mortgage costs as well too. So being able to get up to around about 12%, if that is possible, of course, is welcome. It's far better than 3%, but many landlords are saying it's not enough. And it's just, as I said earlier, the property is no longer financially viable, so therefore they will need to get rid of the property. For some people, this is too late.
Any other views on the 6 and 12% lower limit, upper limit proposed to deliver the taper, this taper mechanism?
Okay.
No? Okay.
All Right, I'm going to... Thanks for that, Willie. I'm going to bring in Stephanie, who's online.
Thanks again, Convener. We know Rent Service Scotland and the Tribunal will consider comparable open market data before making decisions on the rent increases that can be made. So my question is, how reliable is this data in allowing rent officers in the Tribunal to make those informed decisions?
Anybody got thoughts on that? I'm beginning to wonder if this is the right group of people to be asking these questions to. Yeah. Mm-hmm. John, yeah.
And a point as well too that I hold a public appointment as a member of the Housing and Property Chamber of the First Tier Tribunal. So I don't think it'd be appropriate for me to comment on findings of the tribunal. Certainly from the perspective of the Scottish Association of Landlords and Private Landlords, we believe that the Rent Service Scotland in the past has been able to assess the market. Indeed, they've even approached us to give you some additional information, to go to our members and ask them for details of passing rent. So that has helped, of course, to be able to give a good foundation for what rents are actually being charged in Scotland and, of course, what the market might well be too. So we have worked in partnership with Rent Service Scotland in the past and hope to continue to do so in the future to make sure that that data and the intelligence that they have is as good as it possibly can be.
Okay, thanks very much for that. Just to say that we were expecting to have another person on today's roundtable who would have had another perspective on this as well. So unfortunately, we're missing a bit of input on these questions. But I want to bring in Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Convener. I think it's really just a follow on from my concern around the 6-12% and the fact that. It's already been mentioned that the proposed system is difficult. It's going to be problematic for understanding for tenants and landlords. It's my understanding that although there was a rent cap of 3%, when a tenant moved out and another tenant moved in, that caused a huge hike in rents. Therefore, if actually you go into adjudication and we're looking at comparable properties, and we find that comparable properties, there has been a huge hike in rent. We know there's an average of 14%, even though it's only supposed to be 3%. That would suggest to me that those who have changed hands have gone up 30, 40, something, 50%. Mm. So if this particular way in which we adjudicate a rent increase takes into account comparable properties, are we really setting a scene here where we could be causing ourselves huge problems?
Well, if I may come back on that, that's certainly always been the case. So effectively, any rent assessment would look at what is the market rent, less any deductions. So they would look at scarcity and they would have done inspections of the property to see, is this comparable, is property A comparable with property B? So I think there's robust measures there to be able to assess that. But you are right, of course, at the end of the day, that rent could go up quite considerably, because we know the norm is that landlords on an annual basis don't put up the rent. So when it comes to the market, that's when they'll look at actually, do you know what should I be charging? And then they would mark that rent up accordingly. So that's when you would see the hikes in rents. That's not paid, of course, by existing tenants. That would be new tenants who would be choosing to opt to rent that property. So yes, there is an issue there. But we also need to understand that the Scottish Government is looking at controls between rent levels as well, between tenancies, how that could work through, and that would be up to a future housing bill to consider. But ultimately, we need to be thinking about, well, landlords need to invest in properties too. So it's in those void periods we'd be expecting them to invest and upgrade those properties. So if they don't see that the money is there through rent increases, then we're going to see a further deterioration of the quality of accommodation, which is in nobody's interest.
Unless there's anybody else can be there, I'm happy to leave it there.
OK, thanks very much, Brian. I'm going to bring in Marie McNair.
Thanks, Convener. Callum, just following on from a previous comment, if I picked you up right, do you think that Rent Scotland and the Tribunal will have the capacity to deal with the challenge that's possibly going to come?
I think when we've found changes to the Tribunal in the past, actually, we've always underestimated the demand that's been placed on Tribunal, and we can only look at history to project the future, but you could anticipate. I think looking at the Scottish Government's assessment, that the suggesting only 600 applications in total through Rent Service Scotland done, it seems modest, I would suggest. And the resourcing that will be required to have the kind of inspections of the kind of property to look at the marketplace to give that confidence around it is will be considerable. So I would imagine there will be more. However, this is all conditional on tenants and landlords understanding the changes. And I think they're not that, as John said, there's not that clarity because we're running so close to April 1st. There's not that clarity around the changes that are coming down the line. But I would anticipate that, just intuitively, that 600 seems incredibly modest and we will see more pressure on Rent Service Scotland.
Thank you. Thanks very much. Finally, Mark Griffin.
Thanks, Commissioner. I'll wrap two questions up into one. The regulations only continue the rent control element and not the evictions element. So just ask broadly around the table if you think there will be any impact on level of evictions and homelessness as a result of that. And secondly, more substantive, just to ask about people's expectations and ambitions for the housing bill when it comes to rent controls. You know, what do people hope to see the government propose as a long-term approach to rent controls going forward?
Can I come in the first part? Yeah. I'll not answer the second part. I mean, in terms of most local authorities are making contingency arrangements for increased homeless applications from the private rented sector, as well as approaches from landlords wanting to sell property. So that's happening just now. So, yes, we are anticipating an additional pressure after April from tenants leaving, either voluntary or involuntary, from the private rented sector, and that will put extra strain on homelessness services.
I think just on the second point, we have fundamental concerns around the kind of rent controls, but I'll park that to one side for a minute. I think if we have a system that comes in place in Scotland, I mean, at the heart of it, we need data, we need evidence around actually what genuine rents are, and we don't have that, and that will require some time to build up. And we need local flexibility and local control. We need the decision makers at local authority level determining what that appropriate rent level is rather than a kind of national determination. That's obviously what we're going to have through this system. We're going to have a kind of national, you know, up to 6% okay, and flexibility potentially up to 12%. That doesn't reflect kind of the nuances of the housing market across Scotland, where we have spikes and bits are a little bit calmer. So if we get to a point where we have permanent rent controls and kind of and through the kind of normal legislative process, then kind of local determination, I think, is absolutely crucial.
Add to that, I think that rent data is crucial for us to make any determination on what we do with future policy with regards to rent control. I feel it's very strange we're trying to find a solution here without fully understanding the problem. So let's understand what rents are being charged, where there are issues, and let's look at implementing local measures to be able to deal with those issues before we think of national legislation, which might not be warranted at the end of the day. So, but let's look at the problem. Let's look at what rents are being charged first before making decisions that will have long-term implications for the housing sector in general in Scotland.
Well, thank you very much. I think this has been a really constructive morning, and thanks for that, letting us ask those questions on the regulations there. So, thanks for joining us. It's been really helpful to get your sense of the Housing to 2040 and a kind of understanding of what's needed to deliver it. We previously agreed to take the next three items in private, so as that was the last public item on our agenda for today, I now close the public part of the meeting.